One is the Preventing a Preemptive Strike on North Korea Act. By the way, Senator Booker is one of the co-sponsors of that. We're proud of him, and I've been in close touch with his office about this very thing. So this would say that the president is banned from launching a preemptive strike against North Korea. It's all Democrats that are co-sponsors. Senator Murphy is the lead sponsor of Connecticut, but it's a start. It's a start. That's an important bill. The other important bill is introduced by Senator Markey in the Senate and Representative Liu in the House, and it's called the Restricting First Use of Nuclear Weapons Act. And it would basically say something that should have been done a long time ago. In fact, at our annual conference last November 12th in Princeton, Elaine Scarry of Harvard, Professor Elaine Scarry, was one of our speakers. She has a book called Nuclear Monarchy. You know, it's crazy. The single most important decision that any country makes is the use of nuclear weapons, going to war. And yet, that is the least democratic area of U.S. decision making. The president alone can order the launch of nuclear weapons. This has been a problem for a long time. Some of you remember when Richard Nixon was drinking heavily toward the end of his time in the White House. And a lot of people were getting worried, you know, the Watergate scandal and all the rest of that. A lot of people were getting worried. Is he going to? He once, during that time, bragged to reporters saying, I could go into that next room, make one phone call, and a half hour later, 70 million people would be dead. This is not just President Trump, but there have been other reckless people. By the way, there was an arrangement made at that time that the Secretary of Defense at the time, Schlesinger, said, if you would get an order like that from the president, don't do it. Call me. That had no legal standing, though. Nobody knows what would have happened if President Nixon had actually done that. Right now, there's no legal restriction on the president ordering the use of nuclear weapons. There needs to be. This is crazy. The only circumstance that the Markey-Liu bill would allow the use of nuclear weapons unilaterally by the president is if the U.S. was under nuclear attack. Obviously, then you've got a very time-urgent situation. Any other case, it could only happen if the Congress authorized war and specifically, as part of that authorization, authorized the use of nuclear weapons. That, to me, is a sensible restraint, just from a democratic standpoint. These are common sense bills that ought to be getting a lot of support and a lot of visibility, and instead they're more or less languishing. We need to turn that around. That's where our voices come in. We need to be in touch with our elected officials. We need to be in touch with the area media. We need to be mobilizing people to take a stand publicly. I'm part of a calls that are happening every week or two to coordinate this effort nationally and even internationally. So we made a good start, I think. We had 6 events in our region yesterday and now today. My talk to you is the last of those. I think we need to get off our duffs and do this, because if we don't, what's this world going to look like? Well, if you go to our website, which is listed on that material, peacecoalition.org, and click on Diplomacy, Not War, one of the things near the top, it's a very sobering article. There's a lot of sobering things there. There's also some hopeful things, but very sobering assessment of what a war with North Korea might look like. And contrary to popular belief, so there's this bloody nose strategy that I think most of you have heard of. McMaster is one of the champions of it. Says, well, we could do something in North Korea, maybe destroy one of their missiles while they were getting ready to launch it, or do some kind of thing like that, and they would just sit there and do nothing. What kind of person thinks that way? I mean, this would be the most gargantuan misunderstanding in the history of the world. Highly unlikely that that would be the case, that North Korea is going to let itself be militarily attacked and do nothing. So one of the scariest things in this is not only would nuclear weapons likely be used, by the way, one reason they would be used early as one of the first things probably is that a lot of the weaponry and troops that the U.S. would need to be sending over, it's too hard to transport all of that by aircraft, so it would have to come in by sea. So there's an important seaport that would probably be the very first thing that North Korea would strike, and it would probably strike it with a nuclear weapon, because that would sort of keep the pipeline from getting opened up for a longer war with the United States. And then they would probably use their biological and chemical arsenals on people in that part of the world, in South Korea, in Japan. It's a very sobering, long article. It'll take you a while to read it. Something else sobering there is, what are the chances of war with North Korea? It's very sobering to read what bona fide experts are saying. Ambassador Haas, who's now the head of the Council on Foreign Relations, Richard Haas, he was high-ranking in the Bush administration in the State Department. He's estimating as high as 60% chance of war. There's one person who goes even higher, and he's the person who was probably the U.S. senator who was closest to President Trump of anybody. Lindsey Graham. He plays golf with him a lot. He knows his mind. He talks to him all the time. He says if North Korea does another nuclear test, there is a 70% chance of war. This is not some remote possibility. This is a real possibility. We need to take urgent action. We need to engage with this issue right now. And I give you some ways there at the bottom that all of us can do something. We don't all have to do the same thing. Some of us will be going to Washington to lobby. Some of us will be doing the lobbying by picking up the phone or by sending emails, and there's ways to send emails through our website. Right? Some of us will be doing educational events. Some of us will be reaching out to other people in the faith community to say, let's band together. This is a key issue. This is a critical issue. But we all need to do something. And if we do, then by the grace of God, I believe that we can keep this diplomatic surge going. It's going to take an activist surge to make the diplomatic surge succeed. Thank you for listening, and I look forward to hearing your questions during the question and answer period.